In this video, we'll explain the energy balance for a stirred tank reactor, and we're going to look at the general case. So it's an unsteady state stirred tank reactor. Subset of this type reactor is a CSTR or a batch reactor. The unsteady state case would correspond to startup of a CSTR, for example. And of course, another subset would be a semi-batch reactor. So if we write down the general equation, we can simplify it. And essentially, what we're going to do is apply the first law. We're going to look at a simplified system so that it's easier to see where things come from. Just A goes to B reaction. We'll assume the work due to stirring is insignificant. And we'll assume constant heat capacities and a constant delta H, again, to make it easier to see where the terms come from. And essentially, the energy balance, first law, says the accumulation in reactor, so energy accumulation that's in the reactor, is due to the fact that energy flows in, energy flow out, and then the change is also due to the fact that we can add heat, rate of heat being added. So this is heat transfer across walls typically, right? So we could have a heating or cooling jacket, and we're transferring heat into, or we're transferring heat out of the reactor. And so this is the first law. You notice there's no heat of reaction term. That's taken into account in these energy flow terms. And so we'll look at this in terms of enthalpy and internal energies for the simple system. And this is flow rate of A in, flow rate of A out, flow rate of B out. And then in the reactor, we have so many moles of A and so many moles of B. And of course, those numbers can change with time. Flow rates of A and B can change with time. In general, the volume of the contents can change with time. We'll look at a constant temperature into reactor T0. The temperature leaving, we'll assume the temperature leaving, temperature in the reactor is the same. So we're assuming it's well stirred. So even if it's an unsteady state case, we're still assuming that it's well stirred. So if we write this first law in terms of energy of the energy accumulation in terms of enthalpies, internal energy. So strictly speaking, this would be the internal energy of A in reactor times the number of moles of A. We'll write it as the enthalpy, and this is because we're looking at a liquid phase system, which is certainly the most common for a stirred tank reactor, and the enthalpy and the internal energy are essentially the same for a liquid phase. So we have A and B, and we're assuming just these two components. And what we're looking at is the change in that energy in the reactor as a function of time. That's accumulation term. Energy is flowing in because A is coming in, and this notation means enthalpy of A evaluated at T0. This is molar flow rate of A, and then in general, B could be flowing in, enthalpy of B, also evaluated at T0. So that's the energy flow in. The energy flow out looks very similar. Flow rate of A, enthalpy of A, now evaluated at the reactor temperature. Flow rate of B, enthalpy of B, also at reactor temperature, and then the rate that we're adding heat, by heat transfer. Now we're going to have to differentiate this, and we want to be careful because the number of moles in the reactor is changing as a function of time. The temperature is changing, therefore the enthalpy per mole is changing. So if we want to differentiate this, we have to use the product rule. Number of moles of A, the derivative of A, again evaluated temperature T, respect to time, plus the enthalpy of A, evaluated temperature T, and then the change in number of moles with time, and then equivalent terms for B. And so I've written down the terms for B. So this accumulation term is still equal to the terms on the right. And now we're going to first simplify some of these terms on the left. So again, we're looking at a simplified case. So we're going to assume no phase change, and the derivative of enthalpy respect to time is going to be the heat capacity of A, derivative of temperature respect to time. So enthalpy of A changes because the temperature changes, and we can write it in terms of heat capacity likewise for B. And then the derivative of number of moles of A respect to time is essentially the term from mass balance. It's due to flow rate of A into reactor, flow rate of A out, and the rate of reaction of A. And then we have an equivalent mass balance for component B, that B flow rate in and out, and now the rate of reaction of B. So what we want to do is substitute this equation, this one, and this one, into our energy balance above and do some simplification. So again, the left-hand side of the equation, so we've taken our energy balance here, made the substitution. This is now left side of the equation. We haven't changed the right side of the equation. Now we want to combine these terms at flow rates and so forth that are on the left and the right, and do some simplification. So just rearranging now the complete equation by bringing some of the terms to the right side and putting some common terms together is as follows. And you can see this term and this term cancel. And then we're going to use the fact RA equals minus RB. Since it's stoichiometry, it's just A goes to B. And we're going to use the idea that the enthalpy of A at a given temperature would be the enthalpy at another temperature, like T0, the feed temperature. Heat capacity of A, T minus T0. So remember, this is assuming a constant CP. Otherwise, we'd have to write an integral here. The concepts follow. It just gets a little messier to write down. And so we can now use this equation and use this and do some further rearranging, combining terms. We have change in temperature with time on the left side. We have terms due to flow in. This is delta H of reaction for the reaction A goes to B, just the enthalpy of the products minus the enthalpy of the reactants, evaluated at temperature T. So in general, the heat of reaction is going to be a function of temperature. And essentially, we have a general energy balance for unsteady state tank reactor that we can then simplify for the various types of reactors. So what we have here is the unsteady state tank reactor equation, where there's flow terms in, heat reaction, and adding energy. For startup of CSTR, we'd use this complete equation. For a semi-batch reactor, we may need to use the complete equation. Depends on the type of reactor, whether there's any flow terms in or flow terms out. And we have to simplify accordingly. If we look at the case of just a batch reactor, then there's no flow into the reactor, no flow out of the reactor. And so batch reactor, of course, the number of moles of A and B and contents of reactor are changing with time. There's no flow term in. There's just heat reaction at temperature T, rate of reaction, and the rate that we're adding heat. If we look at a steady state CSTR, then steady state means things are not changing with time. So the left side of our general equation disappears, and we have zero equals these flow terms that we're allowing A and B to flow in the reactor. And then we have a heat reaction at the temperature of the reactor. Of course, rate of reaction is evaluated at the reactor temperature and Q dot. And we would, of course, solve this simultaneously with mass balance. So there's various other forms that we could write these energy balances in. The objective here is to make it clear that we can just start with our standard first law energy accumulation is flow in and flow out. And we end up with an equation where we're allowing the heat of reaction, in this case, to be a function temperature. We often assume over a reasonable temperature range that it doesn't change significantly. We're allowing both reactant and product to be flowing in, and we're allowing for heat transfer. We can write this in other forms. Certainly, we can write it where the heat capacity is a function of temperature. We could write it where we're using mass heat capacities and mass flow rates if we wish.